let's put our hands together. We're gonna glorify the Lord because he's good to us, right? You have in here today, God. We give you all that we are.
This morning, as we were praying before the service, I felt like the Lord was saying to me that whatever your situation with your father is today, that he's a good dad and that he loves you. And if you need a touch from him today, he wants to heal hearts that are hurting and broken. And we have prayer teams on both sides of the sanctuary throughout the next song and after the service. If you want to get prayer, I think he wants to minister to you today.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you.
We thank you for being a God of restoration, a God of hope, and a God of love. So God, we pour out our praise on you today, God. It says that you enthrone yourself on the praises of your people. God, let that be a throne to you. God, that we can lift that up, Lord. Every Sunday, every day after day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, doesn't matter. God, that we can pour out our praise, Lord, just to let you know that we love you, that we see you in everything, God. We love you so much. Thank you for opening our hearts to what you have for us today. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Song. We're glad you're here with us to celebrate the goodness of God together. If you're a guest with us this morning, a special welcome to you. Also, happy Father's Day. Everybody give applause to all the fathers. On this Father's Day, we're starting something new. So there is what we call a Connect card, either sitting on your chair or in the pocket in front of you. Everybody grab one of these Connect cards and hold it up so I can see it. If your neighbor's having problem finding Connect card, help them find it. Hold it up. Come on, everybody, grab a Connect card. Hold it up. I know it's early. Just think, you're burning calories. Hold it up, the Connect card. Everybody got the card held up? Okay, good job, good job. Okay, now look at this Connect card. We're going to fill this out quick. On the front there, this is, every week we're going to be doing this. It's so that we can help connect to you guys. If you're new, we want to be able to help connect. If you've been here forever, to help stay connected and know what's going on. But if you look at this, there's a regular attendee. I have updated my information today. This is my first time filling out this card, which today will be for everybody. You can check the 11:15 service. It's 6th, the 15th. That's June 15th today. Your name, address, all on that front of that Connect card there. You want to fill that out. There's some other boxes on the front of the Connect card there. It says, I am new to church life. And nowadays, there's more and more confusion about what does it mean to be part of the church. We're going to talk a little bit about that today. There's an area of interest you'd like to get involved. There's an event. For events that we're going to be doing, you can, if you want to get involved in an event, you can put that there. And then on the back of the Connect card, there's a prayer request area, comments, praise reports, and a map. So this Connect card is something, again, that we want to help everybody that's new get connected and everybody that's been here forever to stay connected and know what's going on at the church. And so fill that out, and we're going to be watching a Father's Day video, and then we're going to be doing the News to Know video. Then the ushers are going to come forward and they're going to receive tithes and offerings, and then just take this Connect card that everybody has, right? Everybody has their Connect card. It's all filled out in happy land, okay? When the offering comes by, just put it in the offering basket, and then we'll enter that into the database. And every week when we do this, the Connect card, all, if you're a regular attender and you haven't made any changes, you just can check that box and put your name and put it in the, and this is going to help us all stay connected. So it makes sense. And while we start to unpack vision of where we're headed as a church, where God is calling us to, this will become make more and more sense. So as you finish filling that out, take a look at these video clips.
Hey, dads. You know, it's really good to see you. I know you may not hear this a lot, but we love you. And we hope you understand how important and how special it is that you're here. You know, there's probably 100 things you could be doing today, but you're here with us. And it means a lot. You don't have an easy job. Parenting comes with incredible challenges. And sometimes it's hard to know if you're doing it right. But you should know that being here right now, it's an important part. In the Old Testament, God gave this command, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, and with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. These words that I command you today should be on your heart. You should teach them diligently to your children. You should talk of them when you sit in your house or when you're walking down the street. Talk of them from the time you get up in the morning to when you fall asleep at night. So, what does it mean to be a good father? It means loving God with all of your heart, soul, and might, and teaching your kids to do the same. And what an amazing example it is that you're here in the house of God, in the presence of other believers, seeking more of Jesus and worshiping unashamed. The young men and women here see you. The kids are watching, and as they grow, they'll remember and do the same. So thank you, dads. Thank you for your presence and example. We pray that God will bless you today, renew your spirit, and draw you closer to Him so you can continue to be a shining influence to all those around you. Happy Father's Day.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Jess, and here's your news to know. Wednesday night summer classes started June 4th, but there's still time for you to get in. We have exciting new classes on the agenda, including Christian Atheist, an opening look into the ways people believe in God but live like he doesn't exist. Sandcastles, Building a Life God Blesses, a class for married couples that will help you discover how to leave your imprint of God's character, effectiveness, and joy with everyone around you. Closer, a class that will help you develop your true identity in Christ. Devo, a class that complements our Sunday morning sermon topics and will invite attendees to go deeper into God's Word. Please note the time change, with dinner beginning at 5:30 and classes, Refuge and Rise starting at 6:30. Kids and youth will still meet, but children's ministry is by sign up only. In order to make sure we have enough volunteers to safely look after your children, please sign your kids up at the access booth. You can still start classes even though they've begun, but please make sure to sign your kids up for children's ministry to ensure we have safe volunteer to child ratios. Just this past Friday, Pastor Kurt started a men's Bible study called Fight, Winning the Battles That Matter Most. But there's still time to join. The class runs from 6:30 to 7:40 every Friday morning in the foyer by door B. There is no need to sign up. You can drop in anytime. This Wednesday before class, we will be having a potluck dinner. Bring your favorite main dish to share, plus any condiments. We will provide drinks, plates, and utensils. Have you ever wanted to lead but thought you didn't know where to start? Ever lead before and know it's time to start again? Become a life group leader for New Song Church with opportunities to facilitate men's, women's, couples, singles, empty nesters, and outreach groups. We believe in equipping, apprenticing, and serving our church community toward growth as a disciple of Jesus. Step out of your comfort zone and watch how God will meet you every step of the way. Sign up for one-day training class on Saturday, July 19th. Details and sign-up are located at the access booth. Saturday, June 28th is Build It, Fix It, Clean It Day. We're looking for volunteers to help make improvements to New Song. So if you have a desire to serve God's kingdom but aren't sure where to put your skills to use, this is a great opportunity for you. Volunteers will meet in the New Song Garage and work from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. and lunch will be provided. Help make an impact that will last into eternity. We are looking for volunteers for the Global Leadership Summit on August 14th and 15th. We need help with greeting, ushering, handing out snacks and drinks, the bookstore, registration, and cleanup. You can help while taking in some of the speakers during the summit. If you're interested, sign up at the access booth. That's your news to know. Thanks for watching and have a great day.
One note on that Fight men's group that's meeting Friday mornings. First of all, everybody's invited. This was our first Friday last week. But it is only a five-week series. It's only 5 weeks. So if you want to come to that, I encourage all men to come to that, but it's only going to be for the next four Fridays. Actually, it's the next five Fridays because one of the Fridays we're off because it's the 4th of July. So, and then after that, we're going to be changing and doing a different session at a different time, so just watch for that. But again, you're all welcome to come to that, guys. It's a phenomenal series called Fight. If you you can grab your outline there. There's some blanks you can follow along with us. If you do social media, feel free to do that, but please silence your ringers for these next few minutes, and we're going to look at, as we continue our two-year series, actually we've extended it a little bit because we're going to be coming up to the New Testament here pretty quick, and I'm really excited about that. But we're in Ezra and Nehemiah. We're doing a two-year reading of the scripture together, chronologically. And if you're taking part in that, great. If you're not, you can join at any time. You can get reading plans at the access booth or online, as well as a bunch of other stuff on the website there. But we're in Ezra and Nehemiah this week. And then also, how many of you guys have seen the movie Esther? Like three of us, okay. How many have seen the movie Esther? Come on. If you haven't seen it, go rent it. It is done really well, and it's a really good show. But Esther, her life is also during this same time period, during Ezra and Nehemiah's ministry. And so Ezra is the priest. Nehemiah is a kind of a governor. And if you remember, we got a map here to put up. If you remember, here's the blow-up of the world, the Middle East. Here's the blow-up of the Middle East. Here's a slice of Israel. Babylon, the Babylonians had taken over the world, basically, and they had taken Israel and Judah captive. They had destroyed the city, destroyed the temple, destroyed the walls, destroyed it, and they took everybody into slavery. A lot of them went over to Babylon into slavery, but most people, the Jews, were scattered throughout the known world, and they were in slavery. It was not a good time for the Jews. And so what happened is the Jews ended up getting settled in all these various lands. And if you also remember, the Babylonians, who are now in our context, which is about 450 BC, the Medes and the Persians have come and wiped out the Babylonians. And the rulers, the kings of the Medes and the Persians, they were polytheistic. So they believed in all kinds of gods. And so the Jews are in this, living in this culture that all gods are okay. And the Medes and the Persians, Cyrus, the king, makes a decree. He says all people can worship their God freely now. If you remember, that wasn't true for the Jews. They weren't allowed to worship God freely, as well as some of the other religions. But they had decided that they were going to make everybody's ability to worship their God, their way, free. The problem, of course, is the Jews believe that their God is the only God. There is no other God. One of the things that the kings of the Medes and the Persians, the reasons that they made religions free to worship was because the catch was, we're going to let you worship free, but you have to go make sacrifices for us. So because we really want to be successful and we believe in all these gods, so you go worship and sacrifice to whoever your God is and pray for us to be successful. So that was the ulterior motive. These kings were like, well, we want to be successful, so we're going to let you go worship. They had a fear of gods, and they wanted all of the gods' favor. So they said, we'll let you go worship, and then you just pray for us that we'll be successful. And everybody agreed. Okay, we'll do that. But Nehemiah and Ezra, as they're going to worship and reinstitute worship, their temple is destroyed. And at that time, the temple was really central to them being able to worship and do sacrifices to God. So Nehemiah and Ezra, they come up with a plan that they're going to go rally all the people who've spread out all over the known world, and they're going to invite them to rebuild not only the temple, but also the walls of the city of Jerusalem, and then repopulate the city, which is no easy task, because the people had gotten so settled in the culture that when the Jews came, and when Ezra and Nehemiah came and said, hey, I got this great idea. We are free to go rebuild the temple and worship our God. It's awesome. And people would look at them like, oh, I don't know if I want to do that. And why wouldn't they want to do this? Because they had intermixed with all the other gods. And they liked all the other gods. And they had made friends with all the people who worship all of the gods. Now listen to this. If you're going to go back to Jerusalem and worship the one true God of Abraham, that means all of your friends' gods, you're going to have to say to them, they're going to say, well, what are you going back to Jerusalem for? Well, we're going to go build a temple and worship God. Well, what, aren't our gods good enough? Well, actually, no, they don't exist. How do you say that nice? There was all these issues. So the dialogue that Ezra and Nehemiah had was no small task. And there was people who hated the Jews. They didn't want them coming back into power. They had been destroyed and they were happy. So this was no small task for them to invite all the people to come back and rebuild the temple, to rebuild the walls and repopulate the city. But that's the task that they're commissioned with in this week's reading. So how does that relate to us? If you look at a parallel, Ezra and Nehemiah, there's just phenomenal books in relation to this word restoration, the rebuilding of Israel, or the rebuilding of Jerusalem, the rebuilding of the walls and the temple, and repopulating the earth. This is a direct correlation to who you and I are as a person. When they restored Jerusalem, this is God saying to you and I as an individual, this is how pay attention. In the book of Corinthians, it says the Old Testament stories were given to us so we could learn. So when we look at the city of Jerusalem being restored, God is saying, now watch how Nehemiah and Ezra, how they rebuilt the city. This is what I want to do in your individual life. I want to rebuild you. I want to restore you. Now, some people, maybe that's easier than others. Some people look in the mirror and they go, oh boy, yeah, I know what that is. I need massive restoration. I used to deal drugs and everything that goes along with that lifestyle. I needed massive restoration. When I read this story, I'm like, this is exactly what God did in my life. And depending on where you're at and what your past has been, it doesn't matter how good or how bad you've been. The reality is, ever since the fall of this planet, when Adam and Eve ate from the tree, we are all in need of restoration at whatever level. And God is saying, let me show you how I want to do this. I want to show you through this story, through this example, this real life example of restoring the city of Jerusalem, how I want to restore you individually. But that's not the end. And if we stop there, it becomes weird. And it gets really self-absorbed. God not only wants to individually restore us, is the reason he wants to individually restore us, because then corporately he wants us to get together, restored people in Christ, to bring thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. He wants to show us through this story, it's not just about individual restoration, it's also about corporate restoration. Look at this next line in your outline there. It says, mature followers of Christ understand restoration. How many have ever restored anything? Would you just yell out what you've restored?
Furniture.
Who said that? Okay, was it better after you restored it or worse?
Better.
Okay, that's a good job. Good job on the restoring. Let me ask you this. Was it better than it was when it was brand new off the line?
Yes.
I like it. That's good confidence there. And some things are, I think. You know, you talk to some people and they're like, this is better than when it came off the assembly line because I got my own little flavor in there, right? I got my own little... And a little bedazzling or whatever. Who else? Who else has restored something? Clothes? Who said that? Somebody say clothes. Clothes? So was that better? Is that the bedazzling we're talking about? 80s rock, I'm telling you. What else? Anybody else restore anything?
A rifle?
Life.
Myself.
We're getting to the life part. Who said rifle? So rifle, was that better or worse after you restored it?
I think it was better. I mean, I refinished the stock and recrowned the barrel and, you know, put some chrome lining in there. The rifle itself was made in 1913, so I'm sure it was a lot better when I was done with it.
Too much information. Okay, so. That's awesome. I'll have to get you a mic if we're going to talk that much. But serious, though, think about that. What you restored... This, again, you guys, in this story of Nehemiah, God is asking us, do we want to be part of restoring things? We all have it in us to some degree, whether it's restoring the kitchen after a meal or a carpet that gets trashed. Whatever it is, we have this restoring component in us that God, by design, put in us. There's this story we were at National Conference a couple of weeks ago, and there was this evangelist minister from Mexico, real fiery guy, and he was invited to India to preach to this conference. It's a God conference, like a universal conference of all religions and all these gods, and they invited him to come and speak, and he's like, well, this is awesome. I get to go to India and speak to 17,000 leaders in a country about Jesus. The problem was when they got there, they found out that one of the guys who came and preached Jesus, the Muslim clerics, cut his head off. Killed him. So he's like, oh, what did I sign up for? Him and his interpreter are talking about, what are we going to do? This is serious. So they get to, they're like, well, you know, bless God, we're going to do it. And blah, blah, blah. They get to the conference, 17,000 packed into this auditorium. And right off to the left, in the front rows, are the Muslim clerics with their machetes. And he's up there, and for some reason, all his boldness went away. And he got up there, and he preached very, very generic. God is love, be nice to each other, don't cut your head off, especially mine. And he just preached all this nice, fluffy stuff. And everybody's like, yay, whatever. Went home, they went back to the motel that night, and they looked at each other, and they said, I can't do that again. God didn't bring me all the way across the world to come to India to share nothing. I got to preach Jesus. So they prayed, and they prayed, and they said, okay, God, we're going to do it. Whatever you got in store, we're just going to do it. So the next day, they get up, and he starts preaching again. His clerics are in the front rows. Starts preaching. And he starts talking about Jesus. And he starts preaching Jesus. You know the difference between talking about Jesus and preaching Jesus? This guy could preach. And he starts preaching about Jesus. But what he did is instead of preaching to this crowd, he preached to this crowd. He was just preaching about Jesus, and he preached, and he preached, and he was not looking over there because he did not want to know what was happening. And on a whim, in his sermon, he looked over and he said, and Jesus still heals today. And one of the clerics just started freaking out. So he freaked out, and he looked away, and he's like, oh, no, I'm going to die. And there's this commotion that's getting louder and louder, and he's like, oh, my goodness, what is going to happen? I don't know what's going to happen. And this old, he's about 80 years old cleric with his son comes walking to the front of the stage, and he's like, oh, my goodness, I don't see them. Walks over to the side of the stage, gets the attention of the interpreter. The guy's still preaching. The interpreter's listening to the story. The interpreter looks at the preacher and says, you got to let these guys up on stage to hear what they said, to hear what they're saying. He's like, no, I don't want to put them up on stage, or let me run away first. He's like, no, you really need to let them get up on stage. He's like, oh, I don't know. So finally, after this little battle, they let him up on stage. And there's this 80-year-old cleric dancing in the circle. And his son standing there watching with tears in his eyes and just the shock that his dad was dancing in a circle. And this minister doesn't know what's going on. So he's like, what's going on? What happened? And he goes, you don't understand. That's my dad. He goes, okay, that's your dad. What about it? No, you don't understand. That's my dad. Well, okay, but what is the point? It's your dad, what? He goes, you don't understand, that's my dad, and he was born blind. And when you looked over and said, Jesus heals, his eyes opened up, and he looked at me, and he grabbed my face, and I get to see my son. That was the commotion. This Muslim, 80-year-old Muslim cleric's dancing in a circle listening to this, and they're all just like, what is happening? And the crowd's just all like freaking out. And the cleric, old guy, grabs the mic, and he says, I've been praying my whole life to Muhammad that he would heal me so I could see my children and see his creation, and he never healed me. And you say Jesus heals, and in 1 second, my eyes open. From now on, we all serve Jesus. Revival happened. Now, you can't formulate that. You just have to be willing to step into it. This pastor, preacher, evangelist, in all of his fear, was submitted to God. Said, okay, I'll try. Even it may literally cost me my head. In the story of restoration with Nehemiah, the world is only going to be restored, according to the Bible, through the mouthpiece of peace. I'm spitting, sorry about that. Mouthpiece of peace of Jesus, which is you and I. You and I are the mouthpiece of Jesus. If we aren't willing to say the name of Jesus, we shouldn't expect the results of Jesus. Listen to this. I have a dear friend, his father-in-law is a theologian, did this whole teaching on the kingdom of heaven. We all pray it, don't we, every week? Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Do you know that biblically, theologically, the kingdom of heaven cannot come to earth unless the name of Jesus, the king of that kingdom, is spoken out loud into the atmosphere. Because Jesus said, God said, I have given Satan the authority of the air, of the atmosphere. Unless the king of all creation is empowered by us to speak that name and that name goes into the atmosphere, the kingdom is not present. Individual restoration, God desires to do. But if we are going to move beyond individual restoration and see the restoration of a city and a state and a nation, it's going to be because us, we unite in the name of Jesus, where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there also. Two or three gathered together, not in my name, I'm not there. I'm not represented as the king. Individual restoration is God's plan, but for the sake of corporate restoration in the earth, that thy kingdom come on earth as in heaven. We see this in the book of Nehemiah. This is a foreshadow to who we are. Unfortunately, in our culture right now, there's trouble. I'm going to show you a verse in a second here. How many know that the church in the world, the church of Jesus Christ in the world, is exploding in leaps and bounds? The revival that's happening in the world is beyond our comprehension. How many people every day are coming to Christ? It blows our brain, but we don't see it in America. Matter of fact, for every four churches in America that close every year, one open. What does that say about us? When Nehemiah went to rally the troops, and he said, hey, you guys, come and build with me. No, I'm too busy. No, I really don't care. No, what would we eat there? It's all destroyed. Where would we be? Where would we live? How will we be safe? No. I'm not going to receive that invitation. Sorry, Nehemiah. That's what's happening in America right now. Christians in America, and listen, I hope you're not one of them. I'm guessing because you're here, you're not. But believe me, there's a temptation in our plan, in our country, to go hole up and to go sit in your house and play church and be a god in amongst yourself. Don't get me wrong. Individual restoration is a beautiful thing, but it was not the end. For God's kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven, it means us corporately getting together, uniting to move things forward. Do you want to receive that invitation from Nehemiah, from Jesus? Let's rebuild. Can we turn the trend in our culture? Can we change the trend from every year four churches closing and one opening? Can we change that? If you don't know the answer to that, you better get close to Jesus and you better ask him. That's his plan. You're either on it or you're not. So we're going to look at three keys to restoration that has to do with us individually first, in our homes, and then corporately in the earth. And then we have to decide. Look at this verse. Nehemiah going through the land, trying to rally the troops. Then I said to them, Nehemiah said to those people that were debating on whether I should be part of this thing. You see the trouble we are in. Did I just describe trouble for you in America? Do you see it? Hello? Yes. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace. You can circle. Go back to that slide first. If you want in your outline, you can circle. Come, let us rebuild. That's the first point. Second, and let's go to the next part here. I also told them about the gracious hand of my God. You can circle that. The gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. They replied, circle this part, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work. These three things are the three keys on your outline there. That God will always walk individually each one of us through a restoration. This is the three keys. He will walk every one of us. That's just his desire, to walk us through three simple keys of restoration individually, then corporately, so we can see the fullness of the kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So number one on your outline, unified with the family of God. Father's Day. Dads, you get this. Is there anything better than when your children are your children and they know they're your children and you know they're your kids and it's you're a happy family? There's not much better. But the question is in this individual restoration, do you individually in this room or wherever you're listening from, do you know that you are in the family of God? How do you know? Look at this next verse. It's on your outline. It says, but all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. This is the key. God has sent out an invitation to every one of us on the planet. And all he's asking us for, are you going to RSVP to this or not? How many of you have ever accepted an invitation to go to a wedding or a graduation? What did it say? RSVP that by this time. And then you go frantic when you can't find the invitation. You're trying to scramble to go, oh, I got to fill out that RSVP. Anybody? Just me? Okay, good. This is the invitation God is offering us. He's saying, do you want to be part of my family? I came to the planet, died on the cross, so you could be forgiven. Do you receive that? Yes or no? Do you want to be part of my family? And the reality is we don't get everything after that right away, do we? Oftentimes when we say yes to Jesus, say, Jesus, I just want to be part of your family. I want you to be my dad. I want you to be my savior. But I don't know what is next. And God's not super concerned about what's next, is he? His first concern is, will you be my kid? Let's start there. That leads us to number two. Dad, you get this too. Number two is, are we submitted to Father God? Do we see God as our father? Are we submitted to him? Dads, get this. Dads, think about this. If you have children, when is the house the best, peaceful, happy? When the kids do what they're told, right? But when they whine and fight, especially fight against each other as the kids, right? You pull your hair out of your head. Why can't you just get along? In the restoration process of the city of Jerusalem, the more the people submitted to God, the faster it went. The more they resisted God, the slower it went. And the more problems they had. Have you submitted to God yet? Maybe you're part of the family, but you've never comprehended God as your dad asking you to do certain things, individually and corporately. He's got a plan. When God has a plan, when I ask the kids to do chores, it isn't just because, well, we had kids, they should do something, right? Even though sometimes that's what they think. You just want us to do all the chores. Well, yes, you're right. But there is a plan on the end of those chores. And God always has a plan. Look at this verse under number two. It says, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Remember, the gracious hand of God was the first we circled. Now it's the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. This is a patience thing. Casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Do we see God that way? It's amazing to me. I just assume that everybody thinks God is their dad. Our creator, our savior, our lover of our souls. He's my dad. I get to go talk to him anytime. It's awesome. But it's amazing to me how many people did not grow up that way. And I don't know where you're at today, but the best thing you and I can do is submit to God as our dad. And submit as fast as possible and don't resist him, because if we want things to go good, the way that they're supposed to go, the way he created us, submit. When the children of Israel, when they submitted to God in the rebuilding of the temple, things went faster and smoother. But when they resisted God, it got worse. That leads to number three. Dad, you get this too. This is different than number one. Number three is committed to the family of God. It's different than unified with the family of God. The first one is just understanding you're part of the family of God. This third one is the corporate piece. God, when you come to a church, if you move to another city, If this is your home church, if you move to another city, I would tell you, biblically, the first thing you do is you find a church that you're going to be a part of. That's the first thing you do before you have a job, before you have a house, before you have friends, before you have a dog, before you have whatever, you find a church. And how do you know? It's just supposed to be your church. You come in and the Holy Spirit rests on you and says, home, get involved. If you go to a church and it says, ooh, this feels good, and I don't have to do anything, and I'm just going to get fat and eat and just be entertained, you're in the wrong place. When the Holy Spirit, when Dad says, get committed to each other and get busy, get to work, do your chores, I don't want to do my chores. I don't want to serve in this ministry or that ministry. Too bad. This is Dad talking to you. If you're Dad, you get this. God has a plan for this planet, and it involves us, his children, in being advancing of his kingdom. But it means we have to commit. First, submit to him, and then commit. Say, who am I supposed to lock arms with, and where am I supposed to serve? We have these servant apps. Do you even fill out a servant app? Fill one out. We'll help you find a place to serve. That is God's calling. He wants to restore us individually so corporately we can be in conjunction with him restoring the planet. That's why we did the Connect cards. Look at this verse under number 3. Christian brothers, I ask you with all my heart in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, is that like this guy is desperately trying to get people's attention. Do you see this? Christian brothers, I ask you with all of my heart in the name of the Lord Jesus, are you listening to me? Do you hear what I'm saying? This is Paul. Agree among yourselves. Do not be divided into little groups. Think and act as if you had the same mind. The reason this is a problem is because we don't all agree on everything. Do we? You're not going to agree with everything I believe, and I'm not going to agree with everything you believe. So therefore, let's go have a little group and go hole up in a hole and all think the same. That's what that verse means? No, this is talking about a heart issue of loving each other, even though you maybe don't agree on everything. But speak the same thing. Agree on the same thing that we are called as, number one, his children, created. Number two, he's our God, and we're submitted to him. And number three, we're committed to each other to make and to plant churches and to multiply in the earth in all of our imperfection. None of the things that you've ever restored in your life are restored to perfection. But they're restored better. That's what God wants to do. Until we leave this planet and step into eternity and look at Jesus in the face, and every one of us will do that, you will meet him. I don't care if you believe in him or not. You are going to meet Jesus, the centerpiece of all history. Of all history, you're going to meet that guy. It's going to be awesome. And for some people, it's going to be awesome. He is inviting us to this incredible adventure. But we only have the few days that we get to be on this planet to step up. And there's plenty of people saying, no, I'm just going to go. And you know what? The Bible says speak the same thing. So let's get 20 of us that all agree on everything, because we're all right then, right? And we are so holy and pure and righteous. No, that's called self-righteous. And the Bible calls that stinky rags. Speak the same thing means I don't agree with everything, but I do agree on this. God created us. He loves us. We are in Christ, and we are called together to pronounce and to proclaim the name of Jesus in the air. If you don't believe that, wherever you're at today, this is the biblical model for restoration, individually and corporately. If you're not on that track, there's no other plan B. That's all there is. And when we stand in front of God, when we stand in front of Jesus, it's going to be so obvious of whether we are on that path or not. God, was I really serious? I mean, you were serious about me, I think. Anybody agree? Would anybody agree that Jesus is kind of serious about this whole thing? Was the cross serious? Anybody? Come on. Pretty stinking serious. How serious should I be? Well, you know, I give him a little lip service every once in a while. You know, I got my slot machine Jesus. I put the quarter in and hope he answers all my prayers. That's not commitment. And when we step into eternity, we look him in the eyes, we're going to go, oh, that's what it was about. But God doesn't want us to wait to step into eternity to have that epiphany. The cares of this world, the blessings that we are on in our country can cause so many problems in our psyche. We get so confused about what we're to chase. What are the targets that we're supposed to place out and shoot for? What are our goals supposed to be? These three simple keys to restoration help clarify that. I'm going to invite up Justin Stanley. Come on up, everybody. Welcome Justin with me. We got a couple pictures here to show. Let's put up this first one. Here is, Justin is one of the coaches for the BHS baseball team, and they won the state championship this year, and you can see the piling on there. Let's go to the next slide. This next picture is of them with the trophy and them winning the state championship, and then the third picture is him and his wife and their family. And so come on over and have a seat here. Justin, as we just said, he's a teacher in town, and he's also a coach for the Bismarck Demons, and the Bismarck Demons have had quite the year because they won the state high school hockey tournament in hockey, excuse me, and whenever I say hockey, it just gets me. Anyway, sorry. And in baseball. So Justin's just going to share a little bit about yourself and how that happened, the championship.
Well, like you said, I'm Justin Stanley. I'm a teacher here in town at Horizon Middle School, and I've been a coach for total of probably 15, 16 years, but seven at BHS. And you guys saw the picture of my family, my wife Deanne, and we have four kids, ages 8 through 8 months. And
so you're pretty bored.
I was thinking of this. We actually could have a starting nine baseball team between the two.
Well, so, I'll talk to you. You better talk to Deanne about that.
Well, we got 5 and 9.
So, or, you know, oh, five us and four, too.
Nine. Yeah,
that's true. We'll be, that's true.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, the season was a real interesting one because for part of it, like you had mentioned, the hockey, we have probably 75% hockey players on our team. On our baseball team. So they're very weird. And we ended up beating Grand Forks Central in the state baseball game, state title baseball game, which they beat in hockey. And I'd mentioned this last service. There was no need to even try to
motivate them.
Amped up and motivated because it was looking across at the other dugout. All they were just seeing was, you know.
Next year, you guys are gonna have a target on your heads.
Yeah, and I think we do every year from every other team. But
so when, and that was just a couple of weeks ago here.
Yep, 2 weeks ago, actually, pretty much to the day. So
awesome.
Yeah.
So now, how does as we think about restoration, I know that you and Deanne, God has really restored your marriage and your family, but how does he do that practically? What do you guys do in your personal disciplines to involve God in your lives so that you can have all that he's created you to be?
Yeah, within our family, like you said, there has been a lot of restoration in the past few years, and what we try to do, and it's really, you know, simple things, is obviously pray together and pray with our kids, and we definitely try to model, not just in the home but outside of the home, because they'll see us too outside the home with people. Try to model, what is it really like to have a strong relationship with God, and
so is that something you grew up with?
No. Absolutely not. It's actually probably within the last, three, four years that I've been saved. And, your story, pretty similar to mine, what you had mentioned earlier. You have to work hard, and you got restored. And it's not perfect, but it's better.
So it's then better. In relation to these spiritual disciplines, as we think about the city of Nineveh or Jerusalem being restored, one of the things that Nehemiah would do periodically whenever they came into a problem is they would pray. They would just stop and pray. And during the tournament, I'm sitting at home minding my own business, and my phone buzzes. And tell them what happened.
Yeah, so we, I get a lot of texts and stickers and stuff from Deanne. Good luck, babe, and that kind of stuff. And I was driving to the field and in Mandan, and Kurt came to my mind. I was like, I should probably text him and, you know, let him know we're in the state title game, and, you know, just need some prayer from him. So I sent the text.
Oh, this is actually the first game.
Before the state title game. Yep, before the first game. Sorry, and get one back. You know, good luck, praying for you guys and for all the guys on the field, and we won. And baseball players and, you know, like I said, hockey players who were very superstitious with our routines and things, and we need to.
Got to, you know, put the socks on right.
Yep, do the same thing all the time. And our head coach buys about $30 worth of snacks before every game and eats about, you know, $5 worth. But so anyways, I sent him the next day, and same thing. The outcome was victory, and got into the state title game and sent him one. And he sent back good luck. And Deanne had sent me a text to, good luck, babe. And sent one right after that as well, and said, Ava just told me that God said that you were bringing home a trophy today.
And that's the second from the right there, the six-year-old.
Yep. And, she's my six-year-old. And so I was like, this is awesome. You know, I was already excited and went up to our head coach and was like, Jim, I got something to tell you. And I said, I just got a text, and Ava said that God told her we're bringing home a trophy today. And he just looked at me and went, that makes me feel so much better. God said that?
Yeah. Yep.
Feels so much. And he casually strolled away and went about his business, and it's probably jumping around, you know, in his mind. But it was a really cool thing, because an hour and a half later we were, you know, you guys saw the picture there. We won the game, so.
So, you know, this is, as a coach, as a teacher, whatever it is that you are involved in, you know, the individual restoration that God has done in their marriage, in their family, is not to end there. It's to go from there. But that's not always easy. I'm sure that a tightrope sometimes in the public school system and in the coaching, you don't want to be rude or abrasive. So how does that flush out?
Yeah, and I have some good friends that coach in the... Well, it's Shiloh and St. Mary's too, and we're in a little bit different situation, it feels like, anyways, as far as how we can verbally go about, you know, well, God got us here, you know, guys, you didn't get here, you know, and it's very easy in sports to think that way, and in your own personal life, and we've had lots of conversations about that. This feels like you are walking on a tightrope of how you can really let these guys know that. And I guess the way that I look at it with the players and you know, is that for one, I'm their teacher. I'm not necessarily a coach. You know, a coach is a good term, but I'm a teacher first. And anybody in a leadership position, I really feel is a teacher, you know, whether or not you're
good, you know, or bad at it.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, if you're a manager, or, you know, we're a teacher if you're in a leadership position. But it just to model to them, you know, life isn't just baseball. You know, we're here playing baseball. It's a great game. We're learning a lot from it, but you're going to be learning a lot more from you know, the situations that God puts you in. And if we win the game, great, we're going to be excited, dogpiling. But if not, you're going to get a valuable lesson from him as well. And you kind of have to look at the big picture when you're working with kids of that age, is, you know, where do you want them to be in 5-10 years? Baseball or sports might be there, but more than likely it probably will not be.
Where real life
God
stuff
is always going to be there for you. So,
yeah. So when it comes to other disciplines, prayer, you know, what other disciplines have you and Deanne, for your family and for just in general life, what other things have you done?
Yeah, I really enjoy writing and journaling, and that really helps me get some stuff off my mind. I was writing some stuff out for this, and I got a whole front and back thing.
You got about
I can't read
3 hour
you know,
sermon right there.
I couldn't sit here and read it, but I get all these thoughts in my mind, and I feel like I, you know, God wants me to put them down on paper. That's a big one for me. Like I said, the praying and the modeling and, you know, really modeling that for our kids is big. You know, our kids are with us every day, and we obviously want them to grow up with a strong relationship to God, and that, you know, translates to the kids that I work with outside my family too.
So now you have a Bible verse on your arm.
I do.
Yep. And this is one of your life verses. If you guys don't know what a life verse is, I encourage everybody to find some. They're just phenomenal little gauges and guides for our life. But what? Tell us the one you have there.
Yeah. I'd show you. I think my white shirt's too bright, though. And it's 1 Corinthians 16:13. It's be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, and be strong. And that's... I guess whether it's gonna be my life verse or not, it's tattooed on my arm, so it's gonna be. But no, it's very powerful to me, and it just 3 years back, I think I got it, and it kind of just came to me to look at the verse and looked at it, and I said that's awesome, and I'm gonna get that tattooed on my arm, but it's a very powerful one to me, and I can always look at it and feel reassured that God is with me and stay strong, and he will, you know, he will come through for me.
Well, we want to pray for Justin and his I don't want to call it career or ministry, really. And I hope that all of us, from hearing his example and story, is something that we can interpolate to ourselves. It's a tension for him to embrace, what do I or do I not say to the kids, to the coaches, to my classroom, teachers? What do I say or not say? And it's easier to just avoid the tension altogether. Just say, I'll be fine, I'll be strong, I'll be good, and I'll be healthy, but I'm not gonna embrace that tension of what God might be saying to me or not saying to me. And he'll lead and guide, just like that verse on his arm. If we will just ask God, you know what? I know you're not going to make me a nut job, right? He's going to take apprehension and replace it with peace. And he's going to take fear and he's going to replace it with courage. And he's going to guide us into our relationship with him, in the relationship to others, so that we can be the light that God has created us and intended for us to be, for people that desperately need it. So if you guys would all extend your hands out to Justin, we're just going to pray here. God, we thank you for Justin and for putting him in the public school system and in this coaching role. Lord, for restoring his family and doing a great work there, and for showing him and his family how to live lives that you intended for them so they can be fulfilled and solid the way you intended. And God, we pray for him as he continues to navigate the public school system and the coaching. Lord, thank you that you do guide in peace and in joy. Lord, I just pray that you open the doors that need to be opened. Lord, I pray that you will give him that favor in front of him as he walks into these situations, that he won't have to create situations. He'll just walk through the situations that you allow and give him. So God, we again thank you for what you're doing, and we love you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's give him a round of applause. Thanks, buddy. So there's one more verse on your outline there. It says, and so Jesus is able now and forever to save from the punishment of sin all who come to God through him, because he lives forever to pray for them. Do you know that Jesus is praying for you right now? For your individual restoration, for your involvement in the corporate restoration of the earth? He sent you the invitation. He's asking you for an RSVP. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your goodness, your faithfulness to us. Thank you that in all the cares of this world, all the stresses of these of our lives, that as we turn to you and call on you, you will bring that supernatural peace that passes all understanding. That where there should be no peace, you will provide peace. Where there is no joy, you will provide joy. Where there is confusion, you will provide clarity. As we just turn to you, because you are God, you are able. So if there's anybody here this morning and you're to say, you know what, I've never accepted the invitation in number one, which is unified in the family of God. I never see myself as a child of God, as a son or a daughter. Maybe you've seen God as a big dictator, or maybe you just don't even think about God, but maybe something this morning has triggered and you're saying, you know what, I want to be part of that family. I want to consciously accept what Jesus did on the cross for me. And it's really simple. It's just a matter of saying yes. Saying, Jesus, you have already sent the invitation and I'm just replying to it, yes, I'll be there. I'm here. I want to be part of your family. If that's you, just in your heart, say yes. And then the second one is submitted to God as our Father. Maybe you're here this morning and you are a child of God. You believe you are a child of God. You've accepted Christ's sacrifice for you. But your whole relationship to God is maybe dysfunctional, where you don't see him as that big dad that you can, with a big lap, that you can crawl up into his lap and just tell him everything and anything. And you can listen and have him help you through every issue of life. Maybe you haven't seen God that way as your dad. Maybe you didn't think he had the best plan for you because he's trying to wreck your life. But that's not true. God wants to come in and restore and rebuild. He's got the plan, the best plan. So if you're there, if you're at that point in your life where I've never seen God as my dad, as my coach, as my creator with a plan, and but I want to change, you just say yes. So God, I want to say yes to that. And then the third thing is committed to the team. Maybe you're here this morning and you've never seen involvement in the church that God commissioned each one of us to be in. And you haven't seen it as a team that you're supposed to lock arms with, and you're saying, you know what, I need to rearrange my schedule. Just as Nehemiah rallied the troops and said, come on, let's do this thing. You have to respond. Do you want to be part of that? In the weeks and the months and the years ahead, we're going to work as a church to start planting churches. This is the vision. And if you are saying, man, I want to get into that. I want to be part of that mix. I want to be part of the movement of the kingdom moving forward. Maybe you've seen church, however you were brought up, church was something else. It was a Sunday morning tradition, entertainment, I don't know. But God is saying, no, it's much bigger than that. This is a family and a force that under my mighty and gracious hand, we are going to move forward. Do you want to be part of that? If that's you, just say yes in your heart. And God will lead and guide the next step. God, we commit it all to you, and we ask this in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. If you're making that step today, this morning for the first time, there's a booth out here that says yes. If you're saying yes to Jesus for the first time, please go out there. They got a packet and a gift there for you. They'd love to help you. If you're saying yes to Jesus for the first time, I would love to meet you right down front here. If you're a guest with us, I'd like to meet you too. If you'd be interested, I'd love to meet you. And there's at the access booth, if you're a guest, there's some information and gifts out there as well for you. Let's all stand together. There's one more line on your outline. It says, embracing restoration is growing in Christ. Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. Happy Father's Day.
And with a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim that you are good. That you are good. And in the sun and rain, my life celebrates, 'cause you are good. You are good. And with a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim, you are good. Yes, you are good. And in the sun and rain, my heart celebrates, 'cause you are good. 'Cause you are good. Good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me, and I'll sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good to me.